In this training video, I will explain the capabilities of the TPS6521815 device and its programming procedure. This one-page overview for the Boost XL-TPS65218 explains some of the features of the BoosterPack programming board and shows a simple block diagram of the TPS6521815. The TPS6521815 is a PMIC that integrates 5 buck converters, 3 load switches, 1 LDO, and 1 buck boost converter for up to 10 power rails required by the system. The input supply is monitored with undervoltage lockout, and the regulators are monitored by voltage supervisors to ensure the system is powered correctly as it was programmed. There is an I2C digital interface for reprogramming the double EEPROM and communicating with the device in real time when the system is running. Multiple dedicated and general purpose input and outputs can be used to indicate power good, generate an interrupt, wake up the processor, warm reset the core rails, among other features. The PMIC state machine allows the system to enter multiple low power modes, and 2 of the DC-DC converters can run off a backup battery for powering a real-time clock in the system. The typical PMIC programming flow for the TPS6521815 is as follows. First, identify your system power requirements. Typically, this involves drawing a block diagram or creating a power tree for the processor that will be powered by the PMIC. Second, load the register map settings into the IPG-UI or use the graphical user interface to manually set the desired values for the TPS6521815 output voltages, sequence timing, and other configuration parameters such as power good delay and undervoltage lockout threshold. The IPG-UI software was created by TI to easily communicate with the PMIC device. Alternatively, any other form of I2C communication can be used to program the PMIC. Third, program and test a sample PMIC unit using the programming board, as shown in the photograph. The TPS6521815 sample will be inserted into the socket of the Boost XL-TPS65218 booster pack. The booster pack is situated on top of an MSP430 launch pad, and the launch pad is connected to the computer running the IPG-UI software with a USB-A to micro-B cable. The MSP430 launch pad is configured to work as an adapter between the GUI and the booster pack. Fourth and finally, you can either solder down the TPS6521815 sample on the TPS6521-EVM-100 board, available on TI.com, or the samples that have been programmed can be soldered down directly on a prototype board of the final embedded processor system. Because the TPS6521815 register map is backed by reprogrammable double EEPROM memory, the samples can be reprogrammed even after they are soldered down on a board, as long as I2C communication is available. In this first example, I will explain how the TPS6521815 can be used to power the NXP IMX6 ULL and 6 ultralight processor variants. When programming the PMIC, it is a good idea to open the GUI with the Boost XL-TPS65218 connected to the computer through the MSP430 launch pad. Ensure a sample is inserted correctly into the socket and power on the booster pack board with a switch. A couple important notes before we begin. When you are programming the PMIC, it is a best practice to change the value of the strict bit to 0, which configures the voltage supervisors for the PMIC regulators to use their wide limits. Using the wide limits and disabling the DC-DC or LDO before you change the voltage will prevent unexpected resets that may be caused by large deltas from the default voltage to the new voltage. This is especially true for negative voltage deltas that take additional time to transition due to charged capacitors with no load applied. Now you can walk through a processor power tree or system power block diagram, like the one shown here, and write to the registers of the PMIC in real time. The actual reprogramming of the double EEPROM memory can be done multiple times, but it is common to reprogram the entire device one time after all settings are configured properly for the system. Let's take a minute to discuss the differences between the i.MX 6ULL processor compared to the AM335X and AM437X Satara processors from TI, which use the TPS6521815D0 as its default PMIC. For the sake of this example, I will be reprogramming a TPS6521815D0 device so that it powers the NXP i.MX6ULL instead of the Satara AM335X or AM437X processors. In most cases, it would be easier to order TPS6521815 samples and program them for the target processor that you intend to power. Throughout this example and the next example, as I explain the voltages shown on the block diagram, you can follow along with the GUI demonstration for a step-by-step look at how to change the values in the register map to prepare for programming the PMIC. You can also monitor the video feed of the Boost XL-TPS65218 booster pack and MSP430 launchpad, which is connected to the computer, to verify the voltage is changing in accordance with the GUI when I write I2C data to the device under test. A multimeter will be connected to show the voltage on the pin in real time. Towards the end of the video, I will modify the sequence registers to match the block diagram, then reprogram the PMIC to store all the information in the non-volatile double EEPROM memory. The configuration, output voltage, and sequence timing registers will be correct for the new processor after I cycle power to the board. When I turn the board on again, I will capture the power on sequence using a Sailier logic analyzer as a digital oscilloscope. The core rails of the Satara AM335X and AM437X, named VDD Core and VDD MPU, are set to 1.1 volts by default, powered from DC-DC1 and DC-DC2, respectively. The core rails of the NXP i.MX6 processor, named VDD SoC and VDD ARM, can be powered from 1.275 volts or 1.35 volts and are tied together to DC-DC1 in this design. 1.275 volts will be the default, and the nearest value greater than 1.275 volts is 1.28 volts. So DC-DC1 will be programmed to output this voltage by default. For Satara AM335X and AM437X, DC-DC3 will be used to power the DDR memory. DDR3, DDR3L, and DDR4 are configured by the DC-34 select pin, and no reprogramming is required. For both i.MX6ULL and Ultralight, DC-DC2 will be used to power the DDR memory. DDR3L is used in this design, so the DC-DC2 regulator will be programmed to output 1.35 volts by default. For Satara AM335X and AM437X, DC-DC4 is used to supply 3.3 volts for analog and I/O, while LDO1 is used to supply 1.8 volts for analog and I/O. For i.MX6ULL, DC-DC3 will be used to supply 3.3 volts for the VDD high in rail, which also supplies the analog VDD A3V3 rail and the NVCC 3V3 rail for I/O through load switch 1. DC-DC4 will be used to supply 1.8 volts for NVCC 1V8. In the Satara AM335X and AM437X design, DC-DC5 and DC-DC6 are used to supply power to the always-on real-time clock, or RTC domain. These rails power on first and keep the RTC running from a backup coin cell battery. Similarly, the most critical rail for the i.MX6ULL power supply design is the VDD SNVS in supply, which must be powered on first by the sequencer. The power on sequence numbers are shown as circled numbers on the block diagram. Here, there is a zero above the DC-DC6 supply, indicating this rail is enabled first. DC-DC5 is not used in this design. Additionally, GPO1 and GPO3 are shown in the i.MX6 ULL solution and can be used to control the enable pin of an external LDO or DC-DC regulator. These general purpose outputs are also sequenced automatically, but this feature is not used in the Sitara AM335X and AM437X system. Finally, remember that the voltage supervisors for the PMIC are set to their wide limits with the strict bit having a value of 0. This is okay for the i.MX6 ULL processor and many SoCs that can be powered by the TPS6521815 device. The tight limits, active when the strict bit is set to a value of 1, are only required for Sitara AM43X systems. I have just captured the newly programmed power-up sequence using the Salier Logic Analyzer, triggering on the rising 5-volt input applied to the PMIC when I move the switch to the on position. I am measuring the analog voltage on all power rails and the logic value for digital outputs. The measurement added shows the time from when power is applied to when Pgood is high. In this example, I will explain how the TPS6521815 can be used to power the NXP i.MX7 dual processor. DC-DC1 is set to 1 volt to provide power to VDD ARM and VDD SoC. This voltage rail can increase to 1.1 volts in the runtime environment due to an increase in the processor CPU frequency. This is known as dynamic voltage frequency scaling, or DVFS. DC-DC2 is set to 1.35 volts to provide power to NVCC DRAM and the DDR3L memory in the system. An additional DDR terminator, the TPS51200, is used in this design to provide VREF, half of 1.35 volts, or 0.675 volts, for DDR as a sink or source reference voltage. DC-DC3 and DC-DC4 are out of order on this diagram. Note that DC-DC4 can only provide 1.6 amps and can operate as a buck or boost converter to generate 3.3 volts from a battery. DC-DC4 is powering 3.3 volt digital inputs and outputs, while DC-DC3 is powering 1.8 volt digital inputs and outputs in addition to some analog rails such as VDDA1P8N. LDO1 is set to 1.5 volts to provide a clean supply for an optional MPCIE add-in card. This 1.5 volt rail may not be used in every i.MX7 system, but most embedded processor systems have one peripheral IC, such as MPCIE or an Ethernet PHY, that requires an additional voltage supply not required by the processor. Here, I am changing the sequence registers SEQ1 through SEQ7 to match the power-up sequence for the i.MX7D processor. DC-DC1 will turn on first in our system, as long as the coin cell battery is present at VDD SNVSN. DC-DC2, 3, and 4 will be enabled at the same time after DC-DC1. When the voltage outputs and sequencing match the requirements of the target processor, we are ready to go to the device controls section of the GUI and reprogram the double EEPROM memory of the PMIC. The GUI says that the programming sequence is finished, so we will read all registers and verify that an interrupt has been generated, indicating the programming has completed successfully and the EE bit in the status register indicates the double EEPROM memory has changed from the factory defaults. Same as before, I am capturing the newly programmed power-up sequence using the Salier Logic Analyzer, triggering on the rising 5-volt input applied to the PMIC when I move the switch to the on position, measuring the analog voltage for the power rails and the logic value for digital outputs. The measurement added shows the time from when power is applied to when the P-good signal is set high, approximately 54 milliseconds. In this example, I will explain how the TPS6521815 can be used to power the NXP i.MX8M mini processor. Notice I said TPS6521825 instead of TPS6521815 because the TPS6521825 is a factory programmed PMIC that is designed to pair with the LP873347 PMIC to power the i.MX8M mini. This is a special case where a user-programmable PMIC design became a factory program device so that the ICs are available for purchase and can immediately be used in any i.MX8M mini design. Here, instead of a single rail external LDO used in the i.MX6 design, another multi-rail PMIC, the LP873347, is used. The LP873347 is a factory programmed variant of the LP8733 device and is intended to be used with the TPS6521825 to power the i.MX8M mini processor. The buck converters of the LP873347 provide up to 3 amps for 2 rails of the processor, and the 2 LDOs can supply up to 300 milliamps each. The LP873347 is enabled by a general purpose output of the TPS6521825 PMIC, although it is not shown in the simplified block diagram. Another difference between this design and the i.MX6 and i.MX7 designs is that the i.MX8M mini uses a smaller manufacturing process technology and does not have integrated LDO regulators. As a result, the voltage required by the core rails is lower than the previous examples. For the TPS6521825 PMIC, DC-DC1 is set to 0.85 volts to provide power to VDD SoC and a few other rails. DC-DC2 is set to 1.1 volts to provide power to NVCC DRAM and the LPDDR4 memory in the system. DC-DC3 is powering 3.3 volt digital inputs and outputs, while DC-DC4 is powering 1.8 volt digital inputs and outputs. LDO1 is set to 1.8 volts to provide a clean supply to 1.8 volt analog rails. Finally, DC-DC5 powers VDD SNVS 0P8 at 0.8 volts, and DC-DC6 powers NVCC SNVS 1P8 at 1.8 volts, which are part of the always-on real-time clock domain. The output voltage for DC-DC5 and DC-DC6 are not programmed into the device. These outputs are fixed, but the voltage can still be modified with external resistors.